Welcome to Asbury. I'm Brother Hammett, and I'm so glad that you're with us today. As you prepare to worship with us on our live stream, I invite you to make space wherever you are for worship, if you're able. You may want to silence your devices and make yourself comfortable, maybe light some candles. Please do take just a moment and let us know that you're here. You can do that in a couple of different ways. The first way is to scan the QR code on your screen. All you have to do is open the camera on your phone or smart device and aim it at the screen, and you'll receive an invitation to open our sign-in webpage. Or you can just make a comment in the chat or like the video. If you're looking for a church home, you're always welcome at Asbury. If you'd like to visit about joining the Asbury family, just email me at the address below, and I'd be glad to work out a time when we could visit. I pray that God blesses you through this service today. We'll begin in just a moment.
Good morning. Welcome to Asbury United Methodist Church. What a joy it is to see all of you this morning. We thank you for being with us and pray that this worship service is a blessing to all of you today. I'm Nick Schimmer. I'm one of the pastors here. My colleague, Reverend Hammett Evans, will be bringing today's message as we start a new series called Won't You Be My Neighbor? And he's going to deal with one of the biggest headaches that we have in our life, which is weeds. And so we look forward to this message, and I pray that it's a blessing to you. If you're here in person in the sanctuary, I encourage you to log your attendance. You can do that on the Connect tab that is found on your bulletin. And if you're watching online, there's a QR code on the screen that you can scan. And if you scan that, please, if you have any prayer requests, please list those. We'd love to pray for you and your family as well. This morning is a blessing for our church. We are, it's the start of OMP week. And so right after this service, I will be leaving with 14 students and two adults as we head to Rogers, Arkansas, to be the hands and feet of Christ in what should be a very cool and relaxing week for us all. And so we would appreciate your prayers this week as we are up there. We are so thankful for this opportunity. And later on in the service, Brother Hammett will commission us all before we head out. With that, I invite you to prepare your hearts and minds for worship as we gather in this space. You to please stand and join me for our call to worship, which is found in your bulletin. This is none other than the house of God. This is nothing less than the gate of heaven.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
God hems us in behind and before and lays hands of blessings upon us.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for us. It is so high we cannot attain.
Rest in the majesty of our God. Give thanks and sing to God's glory.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Amen. Please remain standing for our hymn of praise. It is Gather Us In. It is found on page 2236 of The Faith We Sing.
And we will sing 1, 2, and 4 as the verses.
Please join me in our invocation, which is also found in your bulletin. Holy Mystery, we yearn to grow closer to you this day, when our spirits grow unsettled and groan in travail like our warming planet, meet us in our need. When we seek isolation from the rancor of our time, remind us how the wheat and weeds grow together until the harvest. When we feel captive to the pressures of this world, remind us that we need not succumb to our fears, for you have given us a spirit of adoption as children of God. Pursue us and hold us near, gentle one, that we may truly be set free. Amen. Please be seated.
Someone's waiting for you. Let's go to God in prayer. Gracious and loving God, this morning we gather with joy in our hearts as a community that comes together to praise and glorify your name. God, we thank you for all of the abundant blessings that you continue to pour into our lives, blessings that are meant for us individually and blessings that flow through us to be a blessing to others. God, we gather this morning in different spaces and different conditions with different worries and fears and doubts and angers. And God, we know that you meet us right where we are, that you shower us with love and mercy, that you walk alongside us, that you uphold us and sustain us through all of our trials. And so, God, we ask this morning that you continue to do so, that through the power of the Holy Spirit, you move among us and in us and transform us into the community that you call us to be for this community. We pray this morning for those who are impacted by the heat. We pray for those who do not have the comfort of cool air and a roof over their heads. God, we ask that you are with them and that you provide them the coolness of your love in this difficult time. We pray this morning for our youth at Asbury who are bravely stepping out to be the hands and feet of Christ in our community as they have continued to do all summer. God, we ask that you are with them as they travel to Rogers, Arkansas. We ask that you walk alongside them and that you present with them those amazing opportunities of kindness and of fellowship for those that we encounter. God, we pray this morning for our nation. We pray this morning for the world, that your peace may rain down on all. And God, we pray for those here in our Asbury community who are in need of your healing and in your love and of your grace. We pray specifically for Clifford Smith and for June Glacier. We pray for Fred Williams and for Barbara Clark. We pray for Megan Arnold and Joyce Dennis. We pray for Doug Chenault and Jean Hammett. We pray for Barbara Mills. We pray for the family and friends of Hilda Parr. We pray for the family and friends of John McDaniel. And God, we pray for all of those whose names sit at the top of our hearts, the front of our minds, and the tips of our tongues. We know that you are at work in all of those lives in a mighty way. And so we ask this morning that your will be done. And God, above all else, we give you thanks for your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you for the heavy price he paid on the cross, a price we could not pay ourselves. We thank you for the victory over sin and death that occurred at his resurrection. We thank you, God, for all that he has taught us, all that he is teaching us, and all that he will teach us. And we thank you, God, for this moment, for the beautiful power of prayer and the ability to bring our burdens and our joys to you. We thank you for knowing how to pray. Jesus taught us that through the Lord's Prayer. We will now unite our voices and say that together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we move into our time of offering, I couldn't help but think about weeds this morning, the weeds that are probably overtaking my garden after 3 weeks gone with the OMP, but with the youth group. But I also think about some of the weeds we encountered in Puerto Rico, and those that went remember, they were some of the longest and sturdiest and most invasive weeds I've ever seen. And I mean, the roots went on for feet and yards. And, you know, the weeds of our lives are like that. Sometimes the roots are really, really deep, and it's only through the Lord that we can be severed of those and grow and thrive. We've had the opportunity, the blessed opportunity here at Asbury, to do that across our city and across the world this summer. And so we ask today that during this time of offertory that we are reminded that we are called to be the ones to pull the weeds of our culture and to bring people to know Christ. And so during this time, I ask that that spirit moves within you. Let us pray. Gracious, loving God, we thank you for this blessed opportunity to participate in your kingdom and in the kingdom building process. We thank you for having the ability to be the hands and feet of Christ, to move amongst our community, to provide love and fellowship, and to meet the needs of those in our community who have great, deep needs, both physical, spiritual, mental, in any way. God, we know that we are called to meet that. So God, we thank you today for this blessed opportunity, and we ask that your Holy Spirit move powerfully among us during this time of giving. It's in your Son's beautiful name we pray. Amen.
way, for to such as these belongs the kingdom of God. And so I invite our kids to come up and meet Greg Stansel today for our children's message.
Friends. How are you?
Good.
I like everybody being good. Who looks at us and decides if we are doing right and wrong?
God.
You're right. God's the one that really is going to look at us to determine if we're right and wrong. Reverend Hammett, in a few minutes, is going to be teaching us. He's going to be teaching us about the good seed and the bad seed. And I encourage you to really listen to what he has to say, because it's a lesson from Jesus.
Okay. Do you mean like the one from the book of good seed and bad seed?
It's from the book of the Bible, and it's a lesson that Jesus gave us. And it's a really good one. But today, we're going to create our own story. How about if we make our own story for a couple of minutes? You are the judge.
What's a judge?
Well, I tell you what, I'm going to make it real simple for you. All you've got to do is figure out which is better looking. Okay. All right. That sounds kind of simple. All right, so from seeds, flowers grow, right? Okay, I have a nice little flower right here, right? Yeah, it's a flower that kind of comes off a tree. Would you say this is a good-looking flower? Yeah, I think that's a good-looking flower, too. Can you hold that up for us? Hold on just a second here. Let's hold that up. All right. Hold that up for us. Good. All right. Now it's going to get, the story's going to get a little harder. Look at this flower. Yeah, it's a nice looking flower. Would you say that this flower is better looking than that flower? Oh, we got some that say, oh, yeah, it is. Some that are saying, yeah, you think that one's better? You think that one's, oh, you really? Oh, okay, so it's, okay, we're kind of, just a second, I've got one for you, all right. Okay, all right. I know you like that other one better, but can you hold that up for us? You hold that one up for us. Okay. Okay, here we go. All right. Our story continues. Here we go. Wow, this is a black-eyed Susan. Oh, look at that. It's not only got a lot of leaves, it's got a whole bunch of flowers. Now, here's a hard question. Is this a better-looking flower than either that one or that one?
Wait
a minute. Who thinks it's a better flower?
Me.
Yeah, see, look, okay. Who thinks it's not? Oh, gosh. Can you hold that one up for me? Okay. All right, let's hold it up. Yeah, a caterpillar in it? I don't know.
Caterpillar bite.
A caterpillar bite. Okay, now it gets really hard. Okay. All right, we got this one here. Okay, yeah, you think so? Okay. Yeah, okay, we got to decide which is this one better looking than that one? Than that one? Okay. Oh, Wait a minute. Are y'all going to choose the best looking?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Best,
you think so? That kind of looks kind of good in there. You think that one is? Okay, all right. Jimmy, hold that up for us. Okay. Who is the better judge? Us? Wait a minute. Is it us or is it God? God, because, you know, each one of these little flowers is different.
But
it's created by God. Now, I'm going to want y'all to all do something really hard, and y'all are going to have to turn around here in just a second. I want everybody to look up and look out. Look at all these people out here. Yeah, you can wave to the ones on TV, too. But here's the deal. Guess what? What if you had to look at all these people and say, who's better than the other one? Is that our job to do?
No,
that's not our job to do. Whose job is it? Who?
God. It's God's, because God knows every single one of us, and we don't know every single one of us.
Absolutely great answer. Great answer.
And nobody's even born.
And
God.
So, God is a better judge than we are. All right, let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for letting us see beauty in a flower, in a rock, in water. Let us learn to take care when we try to judge. Let us learn to trust that you, God, are the judge. Let us know it is our job to love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our gospel reading this morning is from the gospel according to Matthew. We're going to be in chapter 13. I'm going to read verses 24 through 30 and then 36 through 43. And I invite you, if you are able, to please stand for the reading of the gospel. Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like someone who planted good seed in the field. While people were sleeping, an enemy came and planted weeds among the wheat and went away. When the stalks sprouted and bore grain, then the weeds also appeared. The servants of the landowner came to him and said, "Master, didn't you plant good seed in your field? Then how is it that it has weeds?" "An enemy has done this," he answered. The servants said to him, "Do you want us to go and gather them?" But the landowner said, "No, because if you gather the weeds, you'll pull up the wheat along with them. Let both grow side by side until the harvest. And at harvest time, I'll say to the harvesters, first gather the weeds and tie them together in bundles to be burned, but bring the wheat into my barn." Jesus left the crowds and went into the house. His disciples came to him and said, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field." Jesus replied, "The one who plants the good seed is the human one. The field is the world. And the good seeds are the followers of the kingdom. But the weeds are the followers of the evil one. The enemy who planted them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the present age. The harvesters are the angels. Just as people gather weeds and burn them in the fire, so it will be at the end of the present age. The human one will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all things that cause people to fall away and all people who sin. He will throw them into a burning furnace. People there will be weeping and grinding their teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in their Father's kingdom. Those who have ears should hear." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated.
Well, I have two things to say about Greg's children's message today. The first one is, achoo! And the second one is, I'm really tempted just to say, rewind that and watch it on the live stream and watch it again, and I will just sit down and shut up, because that was so good. Thank you so much, Greg, and so very thoughtful and connected to the scripture reading as well. Well, good morning, and welcome to Asbury. Welcome to the first in a new series. It's called Won't You Be My Neighbor? And through the years, Asbury has taken pride in being the friendliest church in town. And after a couple of years of kind of stops and starts and stops and starts and starts again, it's a good time to brush up on our friendliness skills. And so that's kind of what we will be leading to over the next few weeks. But today we're going to begin with Jesus' parable of the weeds, which addresses the question, who is welcome in God's kingdom? And therefore, who is welcome at Asbury? Would you pray with me? God, we do thank you for being with us today in so many ways already. And we pray now that you will continue to visit us with your Holy Spirit, so that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, you who are our strength and our friend, our rock and our redeemer. And the people of God said, amen. Seedbed. Seabed? Seedbed. Now, the next words that came out of my mouth should have been, would you please use that in a sentence? But instead, I said, seabed, S-E-A-B-E-D, seabed. And the buzzer went off. The buzzer stung my fourth grade ears because I couldn't tell the difference between a seabed, the floor of a sea or an ocean, and a seedbed, a bed of soil prepared for planting seed. Mrs. Wynn had weeded out all the poor spellers in my class, and I was the best. And then Mr. Cohn, our principal, weeded out all of the poor spellers at my school, and even though I wasn't the best, I was still in the cream of the crop and good enough to go to the district spelling bee. But there in that 1970s Harvest Gold Auditorium at the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, I found out what I really was. I was one of those weeds cast into the outer darkness with the other lexically deficient weeds. We've all been there. We have been the weedies and we have been the weeders. We're raised that way. And it starts in preschool. Duck, duck, goose. You're out. Get in the mush pot. You can't play anymore. You're a weed. I got back from Camp Tanico Friday afternoon, and this was my 10th anniversary as the dean for senior high camp. Before that, I served for 6 years as the dean of one of Camp Tanico's junior high camps. And senior highs do this in different ways, but junior high kids are true experts in weeding out others. I mean, it would start on day one, and to our adult eyes, they would all look the same in their shorts and tennis shoes and t-shirts. I mean, my old eyes still can't tell the difference between Southern Marsh and the knockoff brand, but theirs are adept at doing things like that. They'll target a kid. Maybe they're from a big city like Little Rock, and the other kid is from out somewhere in the sticks like, you know, Harrisburg or something. Or maybe it's the other way around. That kid doesn't look the same or dress the same or talk the same or act the same. He's a weed. Junior highers are just at that age where their hormones are kicking in, amen? And boys, some of the boys look up from their PlayStation one day and they see that formerly detestable creature, that girl, and they behold a new creation. And the guys have a pretty good shot at camp getting a girlfriend because there are always twice as many girls than boys at camp. Pretty good odds. But come Thursday night at the dance, you'll see it. Boys standing over there by themselves, too cool to make a fool of themselves by asking a girl to dance, or some girl will be crying in the corner because the boy didn't ask her to the dance and asked another girl. She will find herself in the weed pile with all the other weepers and teeth gnashers. We get a little older and we don't stop weeding and being weeded. You didn't make the cut, take a seat on the bench. Your application has been received, but we are sorry to inform you. Let's just be friends. I've said those things, I've heard those things, and they're all nice ways to say, you're a weed. Get over there in the pile. You don't belong here. You don't fit in. Once a weed, always a weed, we say. Can't teach an old dog new tricks. A leopard can't change its spots. The apple doesn't fall far from the tree. And you'd think that we would grow out of it, but we really don't. History is full of weeders. Nero, Domitian, Vespasian, Torquemada, Hitler, Mussolini, Amin, Stalin, Milosevic, Mugabe, McCarthy, Putin. Too many names to list. An ocean of blood has been spilled in the name of just a little innocent weed pulling. And we know that the church is not immune to that. I have a dear friend who used to go to another United Methodist church. It wasn't Asbury. She wanted to get involved in the church, and so she decided to join the UMW, the United Methodist Women. She went to her very first circle meeting. And some of the ladies in that circle meeting said to her afterward, "We don't think you fit in here. We think you should find another circle." She didn't find another circle. She found another church in another denomination because the ladies in that circle called her a weed. Every once in a while, a person or a group comes along saying that the church needs to do a little weeding. Those people don't belong here. You can't do that here. You can't have that idea or have that committed that sin or be a part of that group or think that way or dress that way or be that way or look that way or have those friends or to be one of us. You're a weed. Matthew says that one day Jesus drew such a crowd that he had to get out in a boat and preach to the people back on the shoreline. And he told a story about some seeds and some soil, and the crowd was hungry for more, and so he told another story about weeds. Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a farmer who sowed good seed in his wheat field. When he was tucked in bed fast asleep, an enemy came and sowed seeds among the wheat and ran off. When the wheat came up and produced grain, the weeds came up with the wheat." And isn't that the way life is? There are weeds among the wheat. You ever notice that? Life is full of ugliness and beauty. In life, tragedy mingles with triumph. Some of us are old enough to remember what Jim McKay used to say on ABC's Wide World of Sports: the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. There are weeds among the wheat. Somebody said, "Well, if God made the world and God is good and saw that the world was good, then why do bad things happen in God's good world?" It's a wonderful question. And it's one that Jesus anticipates in his story. Jesus says, the farmer's slaves come and say, "Master, didn't you sow good seed in your field? How then does it have weeds?" The master said, "An enemy did it." Now, I should point out a couple of things here before we move forward. First of all, this is one of many answers in the Bible for that to that question. And in the question of why bad things occur in God's good world. You know, Scripture says sometimes bad things happen because we make bad choices. Sometimes bad things happen because of the laws of nature. I know that if I fall off a cliff, gravity is going to take hold and things are going to get ugly. Amen? Sometimes bad things happen just because. There's no rhyme or reason. Our hope and our faith come from knowing that God is with us through it all. Now here, Jesus says an enemy did it. And time doesn't allow for us to give a full discussion of the development of Satan as a theological concept over time. If you're interested in that, you might take Disciple Bible Study sometime when we offer it. Now, some Methodists find the idea of a little red-horned demon with a barbed tail and a pitchfork kind of hard to accept. But there is, however, a force at work in the world that runs contrary to God's will. It's in the world and it's in our hearts. And you can call it whatever you want. You can call it evil, the devil, Satan, sin, mob mentality, cognitive dissonance. But something is wrong with the world and in our hearts. There are weeds among the wheat. And Jesus says, that's not God's fault. So the slaves then say to their master, "You want us to go pull them up?" Isn't that how we are? We love to go weed pulling. Get them out of here. But listen to what the master says. No. No. I believe that every church ought to have a big sign out front that says, no weed pulling allowed. And I'm not talking about the grass. And why do I say that? Because of what Jesus says in verse 28. For in pulling up the weeds, you all might uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will say to the reapers, first pull the weeds and bundle them up for burning, and then put the wheat in my barn. And can't you just hear the folks back on the shoreline of the lake? Did Jesus say no weed pulling? What about the Romans? What about the Gentiles? What about the adulterers or the prostitutes? Or what about the drunks or the gays or the meth addicts or the murderers or the Muslims or those greedy corporate executives we all hate or those politicians we despise? When can we pull those weeds up? And Jesus says, never, ever. No weed pulling allowed. Listen to what he says later on when the disciples ask him about it. The one sowing the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seeds are the kingdom's children. But the weeds are children of evil. The enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the world, and the reapers are angels. Who are the reapers? Yeah, somebody got, I heard a small voice back in the back say the right answer. Angels. And I don't know, we have this kind of pop culture image of angels about when we die we become them, but that's not the way the Bible talks about that. Angels are a completely different group of beings in the Bible. You see, Jesus says that even at the end of the world, we do not get to pull weeds. That is not our job, and it never, ever will be. The angels are the weed pullers. Verse 40, so then just as the weeds are pulled up and burned in the fire, so it will be in the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels and pull up all the trappers and doers of lawlessness out of his kingdom and throw them into the fiery furnace. Notice once again, it is the Son of Man who makes that judgment, who makes those decisions, not us. Then the righteous will, and he says, there's going to be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine out like the sun in the Father's kingdom. And then Jesus ends by saying, if you have ears, listen up. In this parable, Jesus says, you leave the weed pulling to me. Why? Because, friends, you and I cannot tell the difference between wheat and a weed. You and I cannot tell the difference between wheat and a weed. And the truth of the matter is that every single one of us in this room today or watching online has some weeds mixed in with our wheat. The good news, however, is that on the cross, we are never worse than God's best moment. Never worse than God's best moment. And that goes for all of us weeds. And if you think about it, you know what happens when we start pulling up weeds? What kind of plant kills other plants? Weeds do. When we try to get rid of the weeds around us, we become weeds ourselves. And we are fit for nothing more than to be thrown into the fiery furnace where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. When I was in seminary, I lived in this small country town in North Georgia. It was called Mount Zion. In Mount Zion was in the country. I mean, I looked out in my yard one day. There was a free-range chicken just running around acting crazy. And the parsonage sat on about 7 acres of land on a hill, the hill in Mount Zion. And, you know, when I started mowing that thing, it might as well have been 700 acres. But one year it came time to mow, and I noticed as I was mowing that there were these weeds growing over in this one spot, and they were really ugly. I mean, they were these really long vines, and the leaves were real rough, and they were green. And I thought about mowing them down, but I changed my mind at the last minute. Let's just see what happens with those weeds. And so later on, these little yellow flowers came out, and then it started producing these little tiny green marble-sized fruit. And they had little dark specks on them, and they kept growing bigger and bigger and bigger until they got about this big. And that's when I realized that I couldn't tell the difference between a weed and a watermelon. And the fruit never got very big, only, like I say, about the size of my two fists. And there were only about 3 or 4 of them that actually grew that year. But maybe if I had been more caring, maybe if they had had more nourishment, more sun or deeper soil or more water, it would have been different. But I'll tell you this, I've never tasted a sweeter watermelon in my life. Do you have ears? Hear. H-E-A-R, hear. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and the people of God said, Amen. Let us pray. God, we thank you for loving us even in the midst of our own weediness. We know when we look at ourselves that we are that mixture of weeds and wheat that we see out in the world around us. And so, God, as we become more keenly aware of our own faults and failures, our own weaknesses, help them to be a source of sympathy when we see the weaknesses of others in the world around us. Keep us ever mindful that you are the weed puller, and it is our job to simply sow seeds, to fertilize the plants with love, and trust you to bring the growth. God, we pray for all of those who are hurting because they have been weeded out, especially those who have been weeded out by communities of faith. And we pray that our church family will be a place where all are welcome, all are invited, all are enthusiastically greeted when they enter these doors. We pray this in the name of Jesus, and the people of God said, Amen. Our affirmation of faith during this series is God loves us. And we'll stand now and say together, the words are printed on bulletin for us in the sanctuary. If you're joining us online, they will be available on the bottom of your screen. Let us unite our voices together in this affirmation of faith. God loves us. God cares for us. God blesses us. God tends to us. We are God's precious fruit and faithful seed. God hears us. God helps us. God trusts us. God tries us. Sometimes we are more faulty seed than precious fruit. But no matter what, we are God's.
Amen.
if you'd like to become a part of the Asbury Church family, if you're here in the sanctuary, you're welcome to come down on the singing of the last verse of our next hymn. If you're joining us online, feel free to shoot me an email, get in touch with me or Brother Nick, and we would love to have a conversation with you about how you can become a part of our church family. If you've never professed your faith in Jesus Christ, Nick and I would love to visit with you about doing that and receiving the sacrament of baptism as well, and please get in touch with us about that. Our closing hymn is "The Spirit Sends Us Forth to Serve." We'll sing number 2241, and you will recognize the tune. Let's sing together, "The Spirit Sends Us Forth to Serve." We're glad to see you as well. Next Sunday, we'll continue this series with the story of Abram and Sarah and how they welcomed three strangers, and that became a tremendous impact. In fact, we probably would not be here today if they had not welcomed those three strangers. I'll just put it like that. So I want to encourage you to come back for that. And now I'd like to invite our OMP group to come forward. If you'll stand over here and face the congregation, we'll commission you. All right, let's pray. God, we thank you for each of these servants who are going out from our church family this week to travel to faraway Rogers, Arkansas, and to serve as your hands and feet to people that they don't even know yet. And we pray for the group at Rogers this week, the whole group, that they will become a family and that we will become parts of our family groups. And even more than that, God, keep our eyes open, because we know that when we go to serve, sometimes you serve us through the people we are serving. And so keep our hearts and eyes open to experience your love from those we seek to help. Give them safe travels and bring them back safely next week so that we may celebrate all that you have done through them. We pray this in Jesus' name. And the people of God said, amen. Amen. And now would you please receive this blessing. Go forth with Christ above you to be your guide, with Christ below you to hold you up, with Christ beside you to be your friend, and with Christ within you to give you hope, love, joy, and peace. Go forth with Jesus Christ, your Lord, and the people of God said, amen.